In this episode, the guys head back to Roadster Shop to check on LokJaw's custom chassis. Banks built, protected by AMSOIL, with support from Roadster Shop and Nitto.
Hi guys, Gail Banks here. I hope you're enjoying the show. If you've got any ideas on how we might improve this rust bucket, be sure and put them in the comments below. And don't forget to like and subscribe. All right, let's get on with the show.
We're back at Roadster Shop. We're with Josh and Mike. And of course, Eric is here. Word has it that you guys are rounding the corner and almost done with our chassis. What did you need to tweak in order to get our engine in?
So obviously it's a pretty wide footprint for the entire drivetrain itself. So we definitely had to be conscious of all the space that was inside of it. I know we got some good information about your dry sump system and everything else for the motor mounts that you wanted. So we were able to basically package it within a front subframe that we have existing and tweak the geometry just right for everything you need for your track width, and able to fit the motor mounts, sight path for the steering system. Exhaust has a clear routing way to get itself out and away from the chassis, and we were able to just get it snugged in there and as low as humanly possible, so that when this thing does lay out, that trans oil pan does just sit off the ground and doesn't have an interference issue.
So Allison offers two trans pans. We got the shallowest trans pan that we could, but then there's only so much you can do with the oil pan on the engine, so that's when we decided to go with the dry sump, just to really tuck it up in there. Yeah. So can you flip back around and we can see that cross member?
Yeah.
So you said it was an existing subframe, so is this suspension that exists now one of your chassis that just is slightly tweaked?
Just slightly tweaked. We didn't necessarily go full house and rebuild everything and reinvent the wheel for it, but obviously all the considerations for this motor were taken into effect, and everything was massaged where it needed to be just to make sure we could get that motor as low as humanly possible and make sure that you had all the provisions you needed all the way around.
So wheel clear, I see you've got a front sway bar on here.
Yes.
And that seems to clear everything. That was my concern with the dry sump pump, that it might make contact, but it looks like you've got plenty of clearance here. Wow, that just is, that's a tight fit.
It's a tight squeeze. I mean, we've definitely had our fair share of close calls and tight fitments and everything, but I think this one's gonna work out pretty well.
Is this the largest engine you've dropped into one of these chassis?
I think probably so.
Spec platform, yeah, I definitely think so. And okay. It's the width is the big thing with it. It's like the length is pretty common on par with what we see for a V8, but just the width of that bounding box is just so different.
The exhaust manifolds, they are, I thought they would be a lot closer to your shock towers, and they're not.
No, it actually ended up being kind of a happy coincidence that with the tire diameter that you guys chose, being able to lay the entire truck out, that trans oil pan sitting off the floor, we just were able to keep them off the top of the upper control arm mounts, which means you hopefully shouldn't be cooking bushings as you drive this thing around, and you've got yourself a nice little amount of wiggle room in there.
Let's talk transmission. ATS is building us an Allison 1000, and any issues with mounting that? I know you. It looks like you made a custom mount for the tail shaft there, right?
Yeah, we were able to build ourselves a pretty nicely torque boxed in trans mount on that using that OEM trans mount that we were provided the CAD data from you, and made sure that you have the serviceability to be able to pull it back and be able to clear the actual torque converter and everything else like that to service in the truck if needed, but able to have a really, really nicely, easily modifiable, easily serviceable trans mount setup.
So I see you got the exhaust routed out. Is that for 5-inch?
That is drawn as 5-inch currently right now.
Fantastic. We had bets on whether you could fit the 5-inch exhaust through there, but
the good part about those trucks is they're way wider than the frame rails, so it gives you a lot of room on the outside to package everything in.
And on this chassis, for if we're hitting over 600 horsepower, where have you strengthened it?
Usually on our spec platform, they're kind of bare bones in the center section. The wheelbases of most short bed trucks that we deal with do not need a lot of center structure support or triangulation. For this, with being having the torque rating that everything has on this truck, we actually did put a second series of center structure on the inside of it, bulkheaded by that transmission mount, and then gusseted and torque boxed all those sections in as much as we possibly could, including up on the rear truss area where all the actual power is going to be putting to the ground. We were able to fit ourselves quite a bit of gussets and lateral gussets anywhere that we need to when we could fit in while still having the amount of travel that you need in the rear end.
So you've done a lot of many high horsepower builds, 1,000 horsepower, et cetera, but it is the torque, as you mentioned, Mike. The torque is the killer. That's what breaks welds.
It really
right?
is.
What other high torque builds have you done? I mean, it's really, it's diesels are all about torque. So
yeah, on the muscle cars and the trucks, even there's a few years ago, we did a 65 C10 short roll base on a fast track chassis, and that thing did 1,200 horsepower to the tires and right around the 980 something torque. Okay. With a manual, and it, I mean, yeah.
That's a fun manual.
Fun manual. And yeah. then we've done, you know, probably a dozen or more four-digit horsepower muscle car stuff. So we're fairly accustomed to dealing with that, that the weight of this motor and then where the torque is made, you know, kind of made us look at it a little differently, or made Mike look at it a little differently and add some gussets where we could.
Well, Mike, I see you've got a Watts link on there. For those who don't know, I know it's a little different than a traditional panhard. How does it work in this situation?
With the amount of travel that a bag setup like this has and being kind of a narrow bounding box, a single lateral link like a panhard with this amount of travel, the arc length that it will end up taking in compression will cause the entire axle to shift itself over. And when you're trying to get the maximum amount of fitment as you can, a lot of times that ends up being a little bit of an issue. Being able to build up with a Watts link ends up keeping the center line of the axle itself is kept within the center line of the truck through the full travel. And also the added benefit is the roll center has locked itself to the center pivot of that Watts link system itself, so it keeps continuous within the travel of the truck, which is a great geometry benefit of the Watts link also.
And more importantly, it's got a Banks logo right at the center point. Come on now.
A nice little built-in billboard.
Love that. And as everything is designed here, you designed this particular version of this Watts link. The geometry, is that's all built by you in-house?
Yes, it's all done here in-house. Obviously, through our years of experience, then all of our geometry that we've had on hand proprietary to us, it's always been an in-house RS system that we use here. So we've had amazing luck with it. Great customers have been happy with it throughout the years. So we've definitely kind of figured out exactly what makes our system, and I think most customers appreciate it.
And with the Heim joints, you've got even more adjustability. You can really fine tune it?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
And that's standard on all of our C10, all of our truck spec slam chassis.
I do notice one thing from laying on that rocker line with that rear bumper. You have that bumper is going a little bit into the ground, so it might need a little bit of hot rod flavor to it.
So we're going to have to tuck that up or just lose the bumper. What do you think? I don't know. There's something magical about that bumper. It makes it look even longer. It is rusted to hell, but...
Yeah, you could just change the mounts and shift that thing up a little bit.
Okay.
Kind of fits the bill.
Got some work ahead of you.
I just love how the mates are set up so well that literally is just changing the length of the shocks and it bottoms out because it's all assembled so well.
Oh, he's looking at the sub-assembly over here.
This is the front suspension module, as we would call it here. So it's the entire IFS system right here, which we do have a separate set of mates right there, which we can individually articulate each side, see what happens on the actual truck, then bring ourselves back over here, rebuild the assembly, and see how everything goes.
Oh, come on now.
I like how that dent translated on the side right there, just like spot on the whole length of the entire rear.
Oh, that's great.
I would love to know the history behind that dent.
That like, was a 10-year-old on a bike.
You think so? Oh, really?
Right.
Boom! You said that it's got full, well, as much articulation in the front as we can get, right? Given the constraints. That's a lot of rust on the top of the truck there. Oh,
yeah,
my God, we've got a sunroof all of a sudden. At that low, are we coming through the top of the bed? Are we going to have to shave some of the bed rails?
We were very specific, and it was one of the conversations, I believe, with the different diameter tires and wheels that were kind of originally talked about. And the taller tire that was originally spec'd, you would not be able to lay the rocker or the rail on the ground without the top of the tires actually poking through the top of the bed. So we specifically were able to pick this tire, which is a 295-30-24, which is 31 inches in diameter.
Okay.
And it just gets you at the cusp line, the very top of the bed right there. So it'll be kind of your flavor about... We'll see where it ends up, when it's actually all together and what you want to do with it.
Okay. But. Now, right now we're running a 22 in the front and a 24 in the rear.
Yes.
And the 22 we had to do because we need it narrow enough and we need the diameter to be small enough so we can have enough articulation left to right, lock to lock, right? Yeah. So we're not making a...
Yeah, with the 24, it left you with hardly any turning radius whatsoever.
No.
Because you're tucked so far up inside there, even at ride height.
And then you've also got the actual inside of the hood line where the seam is, where you have the top of the fender wells going, and you need to make sure you have enough bleed room that when this does air out, you're not plowing straight through there, and you have to rethink entirely how the front fenders actually mate on the front of that, whether it's going to be a whole tubular, you know, fender core support system that goes through, but obviously making sure that you have that turn angle that you have too when you're at ride height.
So we don't want to get into an Austin Powers situation where he's in the golf cart stuck in the hallway and he has to make a 300-point turn. Which, yep, by the way, there's no way he would have made that because it's just not possible. And they just cut and he's flipped around.
He had determination. I think he got it.
You think he did it?
I think it took a while. But he had a couple batteries in that thing, but I think he got it.
But when we're talking to the chassis, did anything have to be done out of the ordinary on the front other than the width?
Luckily, just from our experience with working with 60 to 66 trucks, we know exactly what the trucks need, and we were able to retrofit our catalog of what we already know works and fits on these trucks without having to reinvent everything about it. But specifically that front end, the wheel and tire fitment, the track width, how that motor cradles over the front suspension at the height that it's at, all bespoke just to this truck build.
Do we have anything on blower height or the actual blower to see how far? I know we got that box, but we didn't have the actual blower.
No, we didn't have anything else, which I know the only thing is that water neck is
right.
Happily just squirting out the top of it right there. But I don't know if any of this is, it's such a mess because it's all surface modeling
right
on there. It's kind of hard to really see what's going on.
Yeah, we do have CAD for the blower. So, I mean, at this point though, it doesn't matter to you.
No.
Right? We're just going to have to pop, if it breaks, you know, the threshold of the hood, we're going to have to pop a hole in it.
Well, the big thing about this with the drivetrain is we specifically put as low as we possibly could, keeping that trans pan off. So if you want to lay rocker and lay frame, this is as low as the motor can go. So you're kind of at the mercy of where that blower is going to go through the hood because we couldn't possibly lower the motor anymore
right.
without giving you some serious safety concerns.
Now that the new Whipple, the 3.8, is slimmer than the 5.0, so it might be right there. We won't know until, well, and it depends. There's an intercooler under it as well. So I think we're going to break the level of the hood. We're going to go through it.
That's going to look cool anyway.
Yeah. I think it'll look
that's
cool
as well.
Are we running the FOAC?
The FOAC.
The father of all coolers? Is that the...
No, we're going to go... It's going to be a slimmer one. Current cooler that we're running is 7 inches tall. I think it's relative... Or is it taller than that?
It seems tall.
It's tall. Seven inches.
No.
In addition
it's literally,
to the
blower. So it's under the blower, but it's literally... It's at least 7 inches tall. Yeah.
I think it's right at 7. So, I don't think it's any bigger than
okay.
that, but it's huge.
It's huge, for sure.
What kind of boost?
Right now, well, it'll be around 30.
30?
30 pounds, yeah.
Well, yeah, we had the overdrive set. When we started the overdrive, it was set to, what was it, on the Super Turbo, that was 7 PSI idle?
Yes.
And then we were, so that was at 200% overdrive, and then we worked all the way down to 33% overdrive, and I can't remember the boost off the top of my head. I want to say it was in the low 30s.
No big deal.
Yeah.
Pretty normal.
But it's diesel too.
Yeah.
I mean, in diesel, you know, guys are up into the, you know, low 100s, you know, for big, big power builds.
So we've actually looked at the CAD, I think, enough. Let's go downstairs and take a look at the real thing.
You've got our chassis?
Your actual Banks chassis downstairs.
No way.
Yeah, let's
yes.
take a look.
Yes, yes. Bye, Mike. Thanks.
Bye.
Let's go.
In the next episode, the team tours Roadster Shop's chassis production and lays their eyes on the prize.
Hey, Eric, do you know where we can find a chassis?
I'm gonna go look this way.
I'll go over here.
Gail Banks here. Like and subscribe for more education and entertainment.